Hello everyone, welcome to tonight's show with special guests Daisy Gill, Simon Peters and yours truly, Warren...
What are you doing?
Sorry. Cue titles.
Hey.
Hello and welcome back to another episode of Friday Night with Dean Aldridge. If you tuned in last week and you're back again, thank you very much. If you never watched last week, make sure you check out that episode. Anyone who did watch last week will be able to tell I'm not wearing a suit this week. I've had to tone it down a little bit. Didn't feel very comfortable with the old suit on, but hope you like the jumper anyway. In the news this week, people seem to be talking a lot about this 6 p.m. male curfew. Now, I don't know about you, but I thought that's just what we called marriage, to be honest with you. I'm not going to keep you waiting anyway for your first guest this week. Her name is Daisy Gill, and this is her single, Twisted Lies and Lullabies.
You laugh when I cry, you never want to say goodbye. The tables have turned, now you're gone. You know that you've won, cause when the morning comes, you know that I'm done. There's something in the way you speak, everything is so bittersweet. You know you got a nasty streak because you're incomplete. You laugh when I cry and I never know why you want me to die. You say that you got me a treat, wonder what could be. I guess it's a mystery. Something in the way you laugh, giving me a damn heart attack. Baby boy, I know you well, I cannot go and break the spell. Playing the fool, baby, there's nothing to prove. There's nothing to prove.
That was Daisy Gill with her single Twisted Lies and Lullabies. Daisy, thank you for coming on me.
Thanks for having me.
Tell us more about the song. Where can we download it?
So you can download it on Spotify, iTunes, SoundCloud, like the whole works.
Every platform,
YouTube, a lot.
Make sure you're all supporting it, guys. Well done. So tell us more about the song itself. Can you remember?
So I wrote the song a few years ago, and it was like a poem that I wrote, and then I made it into a song. So the song itself's like a minute and a half, and I think I intended it to be some sort of, I don't know, like soundtrack to something. But then I ended up putting it on my EP that I never released, and I did a full music video for like the whole EP, and then I never released the EP, and then I just had all this material and content, and I was like, if I'm not going to at least release one thing off this, it's just kind of pointless and a waste of time and energy. So in the end, I just put Twisted Lies out and compressed all the whole of the music videos, because originally it was supposed to be like the EP was meant to be like a mini movie. And every song rolled into the next. So what I did is like I compressed the whole of the.
That's the interesting. I see where you've gone with it, but it's interesting.
I know the mini movie into like just one music video into a minute and a half.
Yeah.
It's a very creepy music video. People say it's like very, I don't know. I've had some weird comments.
I'll have to give it a watch. I haven't seen a music video to it.
It's like very 1940s, like all like dramatic.
Nice. Yeah. So how long have you been writing for? Cause
a long time. Like obviously I've been performing around Liverpool since I was 12 and I'm 23, so it's well over 10 years. And then I released my first song when I was about 15. But I've been writing for years, and I used to work with like, you know, youth organisations like Merseyside Youth Association, who used to like help me hone in on me talent and me crafts to like just basically give you opportunities and give you the chance to work on things and not having to pay for studio time, because they kind of had their own studio and you got to just work on songs and stuff. So I kind of did that, and then, you know, I've just done so many different things since being that age. You know, I've released different songs, and definitely been a few different genres along the way, but it's all been good.
You've gone through a few, haven't you? Do you want to tell us about some of them?
Yeah, so like obviously my first song I brought out was Bonnie and Clyde, and that was kind of like really retro-y and bluesy. Some people said it was a bit like Paloma Faith-esque, and then after that it was like all my songs were very country, like Take Your Time was like country folk, and then I started going into like the pop ballad phase, which was like then edging towards more going into pop music. Because
was there a reason behind changing?
There was a big reason behind it, because I felt for the longest time, being like young, and I don't know, I always felt like if I wanted to do pop music I had to look a certain way, and I felt like I had to maybe be like the likes of Dua Lipa, or like, you know, like those pop queens, and they're all very pristine and like conventionally beautiful. Not saying that I'm like ugly, and I don't think that, but I just think like the way I present myself, I didn't think I fit into the category of doing like more contemporary styles or like poppier elements or using electronic sounds.
But at the same time, finding like your own unique way to fit in as well, that works, doesn't it?
It is, because for ages people were like, oh, you should sound like this or you should sound like that, and now I just think, well, why can't I just wear what I wear and be who I am and still just do what I want to do? It should just be about the music and not getting in my head about things and trying to overcomplicate it. And then I think when you're young, because I have been on the scene for a long time, especially in Liverpool, I was very malleable. And I think when you're trying to find yourself as a person, even as an artist, you've got people saying, oh, you should do this, you should do that. It's hard for you to find your own identity. And I think it took me a long time. So that's why, if people have been following my music for a few years, they will see that definite change. I've never changed my clothing style. I love the way, like, the vintage style.
That's good though, like, stick to that, because it's...
But, like, the genres have changed, because I originally started writing songs, like, pop songs, when I first started writing. Like, I was writing those types of songs, and that's what I love more. And it's not that I didn't like country, but it wasn't my favourite. And then when I just realised, after, like, going through different things, and, like, I was in a band, and I was doing this, and I was doing that, and those things didn't work out, I was like, just, I don't, can I swear?
Yeah.
I was just like, oh, fuck it, like, just do what you want to do, like, none of this matters anyway, just do it. But so I did, and that's what I
love, the like, permission that you've asked for to swear, by the way, like, before we've come on camera, you've clearly been a lot more relaxed, because you're just effing and landing anyway.
I know, but I always swear, because certain places you can't swear, and I did swear on radio once, and I got told off for
No. Swear away, yeah. So, obviously, you started writing at a young age, but something I've learned about you, you were actually, you self-taught yourself to play piano
five. No, I did,
Like, that is ridiculous. I don't even think I was writing my own arse when I was five. And here's you, like, playing piano.
Well, me auntie Margo, like, she's died now. Sadly, that's, like, kind of sad. But, you know, she was a big part of my life. And when I was five, she bought my mum the most noisiest toys for me, just to do my mum's adding. She'd be like, ha. I'm gonna get you this, and she bought it as a like almost a prank to wind my mum, because she knew it was noisy. But I just would listen to things on the radio, and I could just like pick out melodies, and I'd start playing them, and then
that's such a talent.
That's just like how I've always been. And then I learned to play the guitar self-taught when I was 13, because of Taylor Swift, so I got a Taylor guitar.
Nice. So away from that, you've got a new song coming out next month, am I right?
Yeah, the 24th of April.
24th.
I have to think about that then, so that's Flying High, and that's like self-produced, because over the lockdown I've got into producing and like learning how to produce music properly. So this is my first self-produced sort of song that I'm bringing out, and then obviously I've got a lot more plans to bring other stuff out in the future that's going to be self-produced. But I'm quite excited, because it's a bit more of a different type of genre that I've done before. It's kind of got more of like a R&B hip-hop slightly pop type of feel to it, but it's like slowly edging towards the place that I do want to fully emerge myself into, because I do realise I've been so many different genres. I don't want to, like, people who have listened to me be like, what the frig is this that I'm listening to, you know, because I've got a lot of older people
said,
who watch
as long as you're finding your way, you're comfortable, do you know what I mean? Especially
it's just like I'm
it's still
song.
Fresh to you as well. At least you're trying to learn something new as well.
Like, because like the song about is like, obviously it's called Flying High, and it's just about like people who piss me off. No, no, it is so rude. It was about someone who pissed me off, and I was like, nah. And they were like saying I was shit, so I was like, you're shit. You just smoke weed all day, how are you any good?
I think you just described every sculpture there. I mean,
basically, he was like, oh shit. I was like, am I? Yeah. You smoke weed every day, and you haven't got a job.
You're going to end the show soon, I thought about it.
I'm such a bitter bitch, aren't I? But yeah, I'll sing my song.
You're gonna end the show singing for us. Well, listen, thank you for coming. Thank you for joining me for the chat. You're my third guest, Daisy, and you've been the most active, let's say that. You've been amazing. Thank you very much for coming on. I appreciate it, all right?
I don't think we should do that because it's legal.
Too late now, but okay. The end with the elbow. So my next guest is a famous actor from Liverpool. You will all know him from Shameless, where he played Stan Waterman. It's Mr. Warren Donnelly, ladies and gentlemen. Is you okay, Warren?
Yes, very nice to meet you. Yeah,
thank you for coming, mate. It's much appreciated.
Yes,
there's only one place I can start, and that is Stan and Shameless. How did that come about? How did you get involved in Shameless?
How that came about was, I got a phone call from my agent who went, there's a new TV programme called Shameless coming on Channel 4, and you want to cast the part of a debt collector. In fact, two debt collectors.
Right.
One's a great big debt collector and one's a little debt collector who are chasing Frank Gallagher for money. So I went to the audition thinking, well, I'm not dead big and I'm not dead small. And there were two guys who were small and big and were perfect for the part, and they got the part. So I went home and thought, ah, well. Anyway, a couple of days later, she rang me back and she went, you don't want for the debt collector, but there's a part of a policeman for one episode.
Nice.
So I thought, well, it's just before my birthday, it's a little bonus. Of course I'll do it. Then she phoned me back and she went, well, there might be two episodes. They don't know. So I did my first bit of filming. Yeah, it's definitely two episodes. Then she rang me back and she went, it's now three episodes because they're going to film a Christmas special. Okay, we've got three episodes. And then she phoned me back a day or so later and went, they're offering you a contract for the whole series. So within one audition and about three or four phone calls, I was stuck in the middle of this mad show that people seemed to like very quickly.
It was amazing. It was amazing how big it went as well. It was one of like the biggest, I believe.
All filming that you do, you tend to do it months and months in advance. So by the time you've done it, you move on to other things. So I'd sort of forgotten about Shameless, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
And then in the January when it was shown, people started to look at me a bit like that, you know. Do I know you from somewhere? And you go,
does that still happen a lot then when you're out and about? Are you always, it's not all right, Warren, it's all right, Stan, or is it
well,
more?
Yeah, sometimes. I mean, sometimes people look at you and they sort of go, like, I've seen you on somewhere, haven't I? And you go, oh, yeah. But it's a strange one. It's a long time ago, Shameless, but things have a life of their own these days. You know, things are on Netflix and YouTube and all that. So stuff that you've done years ago is still out there.
Have you ever been confused to be someone else if they ever got it wrong?
Yeah, somebody said to me, are you that guy who was in Early Doors? No, I wasn't in Early Doors. But I mean, I don't know. I mean, but quite often, I mean, when I'm quite often at the supermarket, nobody looks at me twice.
No,
so, you know, it's one of those.
Is it fond memories of being on set there? Do you have good memories from being there? Or?
Yeah, I mean, it was a very good experience. The only problem is, it's hard to remember exactly what happened because you'd film episodes back to front and inside out and in chunks of time. So it's not like I've got very clear memories of each day. But I had a lot of good times there. There were some very nice people to work with, some very talented people to work with.
Yeah.
And if you work with good, talented people, then it's all a bonus because it makes you better.
What was it like when it came to the end? And it was you just aware that it was coming to the end?
Well, I wasn't there at the end. I did about 6 years. And then what happens is, to keep television series fresh, they bring in new characters, they change things around. So I wasn't there at the end. I mean, I think, unless it's Coronation Street, television programmes have a certain length of time. And you can't be in them forever, unless you're Ken Barlow. So you've got to go on and do other things. And because Shameless is sort of still on, it's like I haven't left. And in a funny sort of way.
It's gone over to America now as well. They've got their own version of it as well, haven't they?
I'm dying to see who played me. You know what I mean?
I thought it was you.
No, it wasn't me, sadly. No, I'd tell you if it was me. But and I think that's finished in America. And it's all good, I suppose. You know.
No, it was a cracking watch. So another part that I'll always remember you for was in Going Off Big Time, where you played the kidnapper. I believe we've actually got a clip of it. Just check this out for us.
Ooh. And a special fried rice with a portion of chips and a carton of curry.
Anything else, Mr. Clifton?
Spring rolls, as long as they're not too greasy. It's like being kidnapped by the fucking Samaritans. They must have been terrified to upset me in case I got revenge. It's bloody marvellous. By the end of the second day, my hands were untied and I had them putting bets on for me. And at night we all got stoned. Five days I was there, it was fucking bliss.
What do you think of that then, Warren? That's taking you back some years.
Well, it's 1999, that's what I think about it, first of all. Which it's hard to believe it's that long ago. I mean, the guy who wrote and starred in that, Neil Fitzmaurice, he's an old friend of mine. I've known Neil 30 odd years, and when I first knew him when we were like 20 odd, you know, He told me Danny had a script that he wanted to work on, that he wanted to feature Liverpool. And good on him, it took him 10 years, but he finally got it produced and made. Yeah. Now, whatever happened to that film, I don't know. I think maybe if it had come out a year or so earlier, it might have caught more of a crest of a wave for that kind of films, you know. But yeah, I got to work with Berners Hill, and
It was a good cast. There was actually a few. I remember Peter Kay's in there as well. It's a cracking. I think it was one of them films that, because during that time, in my head, like around that time, I was still only young. There weren't many films in Liverpool around that time that I can think of. But so it made everyone in Liverpool watch it, if anything. Like,
well, I think the case then and still is now is that there's a lot of films filmed in Liverpool that aren't set in Liverpool.
Yeah, exactly.
Because Liverpool looks like a lot of different places.
Yeah.
You know, you go from like Walton to Belvale. They're next to each other, but they look very different.
Yeah, exactly,
same with the riverfront, the other side of the water, you know. So, yeah, I mean, it's an awful lot of filming, which I'm not in normally. I'm normally on my way to the supermarket walking past filming. But it's not necessarily set in Liverpool, but there's a lot of stuff filmed there, and that was the case with Gone Up big time. But it did feature Liverpool in a big way, so, yeah.
Brilliant, brilliant. So, what was your very first role when? When did you actually go for your very first interview? What was your first role? And can you remember that?
When I was little, I used to go to the Everton New Theatre around about 1979-ish, 1980. And I was always involved with like local theatre and community theatre. Yeah. And I eventually decided to give it a proper whirl and get a proper agent and really sort of go for it. And slowly but surely, I started to pick up work. I mean, I did a thing with Lee Evans in the early 90s. A few things for the BBC. And bit by bit, I started getting a bit of momentum.
Yeah, yeah.
And then things picked up. And that's the secret to it. I mean, you've got to keep plugging away. The more auditions you go to, the better you get at auditions, for starters. The more casting directors you meet. If you can sort of have some kind of acting talent, then you get your foot in the door. So it all seems to go back for me to the late 80s, early 90s.
Is that what you'd tell young actors who were watching this now?
I'd tell any young actor that if you want to act, or you want to sing, you want to play music, you want to paint or whatever, then it's something inside of you that wants to do that, so you should do it. Yeah. If you don't do it, you're not going to be as happy as a person. And in terms of being an actor in the auditions, there's no reason to fear auditions.
Mm.
Just go to the audition, bring what you bring to the audition, and people will see something in you that you might not see in yourself.
Definitely, yeah.
So, you know, it's easy for me to say now because I've been doing it for ages, but I think that's the thing, just go for it and don't have any fear about it.
And you have a big variety as well, like you put yourself into pantos and stage work as well. It's not just TV credits you're after, you've got a bit of a background and everything.
Well, I'd love to tell you that I can turn down work and I can't. And also, I tend to think if it's your job to sort of act and perform or whatever, then you should be able to turn your hand into different things.
Definitely, yeah.
And panto, I mean, it's the hardest work I've done, I think, on stage. So, and it's good.
It's a lot of energy,
but you can earn decent dosh. Yeah. It keeps the whole thing afloat, keeps the show afloat. And I think for me, I've been very lucky that I've done an awful lot of telly, an awful lot of theatre, an awful lot of panto, an awful lot of adverts. I've done community theatre. I've done verging on sort of stand-up sketch stuff. And I'm very lucky because I'm getting away with it still to this day, much to my surprise half the time, you know what I mean. I'm still allowed to do it. I'm still allowed to sort of enjoy myself.
Brilliant. So the last 12 months, obviously, for everyone been a bit of a struggle, but especially someone in our industry and entertainment and stuff like that, how's that took its toll on you? Was there anything that you had coming up? Or,
well, just before the pandemic, I'd signed to do a television job and I'd signed to do a panto job, and obviously that all got put on hiatus. But I eventually managed to do the telly job and some of the panto work. But I think it is what it is. I mean, if you're working as an actor, you're not working every week of the year
No.
So you're used to the ups and downs. So that didn't bother me as such. More the kind of general scary side of the pandemic and worrying about family members. That wasn't much fun. But that's me, you, and every other person I know, you know. So you have to just, well, what I did was just get my head down and get on with it.
Brilliant. Is there anything coming up in the future, do you know of, or...?
There's talk of stuff coming in the future, but it depends on how we all come out of this whole situation and hopefully not go back into this whole situation.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I've got a very much an open mind about it, and I'm staying positive because I don't see there being any other way of thinking about it, really.
Exactly that. Listen, thank you again for coming on. I hope it's not long before we see you in something, on something, wherever it is you may be. But
me as well. Me as well.
Guys, Warren Donnelly, thank you very much, mate. All right, take it easy, Warren. My next guest is a Liverpool photographer who has snapped the likes of Kenny Dalglish, Sammy Kiepier and Duncan Ferguson and lived to tell the tale. Guys, it's Simon Peters. How you doing, mate? You alright?
Good, Dean. How are you, mate?
Thank you for coming on, mate. I appreciate your time.
It's coming good.
I'm going to touch on this now, right? I'm missing my barber, mate. I haven't had a haircut or a shave for 4 months. I can't stand this. Burns my head out. This is why I'm sitting this side. That's my only good side. No, you're looking pretty sharp yourself, mate. Keeping well, keeping fit.
Yeah, keeping good. Yeah, you know, the pandemic, you know, you can go one way, you can just eat loads of food.
As have
just
I.
Just eat. Or you can just go in the back garden, just train. That's what you've been doing.
Yeah. Right, let's get straight into it, mate. There's only one place I want to start with you, and that is this new series you're in. So tell us about it.
Well, again, pandemic, out of the blue. I never thought I'd be doing acting. I done acting when I was 18.
Yeah.
Done my lambda, but I hated rejection, and I just didn't like going for auditions because. Yeah. So out of the blue, I went for an essay, and then the agent said the casting director likes your look. There's a part in a new ITV series. Would you send over a self video of an audition?
Yeah, yeah.
So he sent me the script over, and I didn't think of it. Got someone to video me, done one take or two takes, and just sent that one. Thought, oh, that's it, you know. And then a week later, I got a call saying I got the part, and I mean it's not a massive part, but it's an integral part of this new. I can't give the name of what I'm playing.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm in the new ITV Ipcus files.
Oh, that's so great, mate.
But you know,
I mean that's as you're saying, it's coming away from your. Being comfort comfortable, yeah, yeah, your comfort zone, yeah. Because you're normally snapping people, and then for once you're the man behind the camera.
Yeah, it was. I mean, what was an honour, because I love him as a director, is James Watkins. He won the Emmy Award for, I think, Black Mirror. He done Black Mirror. So to have him direct me for what I had to do was just like, it was just amazing. To one of my favourite shows. Is Black Mirror, like, and he's
you're on set with him.
So again, you've got to look at like the blessings you get from this pandemic's been a horrible for everyone. We've all been, you know, we've had the ups and downs, but in one way, it's made me maybe not, even if I don't go get another acting job ever again. I've got this amazing memory. And
there is a bit of positivity there.
For
some people, there's positive coming out of it. So
yeah, definitely.
Another thing I wanted to bring up, and I don't know where I've heard this, right? But rumour has it you've been to Buckingham Palace and snapped something a day. Is that true? Is that any truth behind that?
I haven't photographed it in Buckingham Palace.
Right, okay.
But I've been to Buckingham Palace for a garden party.
Ah, there you go. So, you went to get pissed?
I went to get
piss with Lizzie.
It was Camilla. The wrong thing for Camilla. It's the wrinkles. I used to be. Basically, how I started photography was. The Prince's Trust was the only place that helped me get on in my vocation in life. So I always wanted to give something back.
Yeah.
So I became a Prince's Trust business mentor. So then I started helping other young businesses grow and develop and give my advice and all like that. So through that, out of the blue, I got a letter from, I call him Charles, or Charlie, I call him PC, saying I was invited to the garden party. So the only thing was, this is the most. It was an amazing experience, but I was married, and I was going through it. I'd split up, so I moved back home. So the letters went to me ex-wife's.
She didn't go on her own.
No. So we weren't, I didn't want to be, it just didn't work. I hope you're not watching this. But if you are, took the house, took everything. basically, I was so buzzing that she rang me and said, you know, you've got tickets to go to the Buckingham Palace, you know, Garden Park. And I was like, wow, this is a once in a lifetime thing. But she said, I'm coming with you. So basically, we were in our hotel and it was just the experience. It was a great experience, but it was a bad experience as well.
Sounds like you needed to go on Oprah after
that.
I did.
I need that. This is my therapy. You know, how much you charge?
Oh, no, brilliant story. Another thing, I've done my homework on your ESI, right? I believe there's a story around a catwalk, an elevator, and something going wrong.
Yeah, big time.
What happened there?
Before I've moved, it's weird, life is so funny. I've done a full circle back. I've gone back to my old studio I had 21 years ago. But I had a big, massive studio in Ormskirk, which was like, it was like 3,500 square foot. So I had an idea go off. I thought, what, I can have like a fashion show for me opening. So just about to go on, all the girls are all ready to go on a catwalk. The MC is about to give us the spiel, and I'm like, so made up, I've got my jacket on, I'm thinking, I'm looking sharp, I'm thinking, you know what, I've got all these clients, you know, and I'm thinking, I'm gonna give them a good time. So I've got a big family, and as our other guest who was on before, he knows Iggy Navarro and the big fellas. So my cousins are big guys as well. So they all decided, instead of getting into a lift, like, it could only get 5 into a lift, they thought, okay, yeah, I'm not taking no, but that's 5.
Tennis.
8, yeah, 8 of them got in, but the big lad, about 18 stone. So I'm like, I'm waiting for everyone, you know, the girls are looking amazing, you know, and I think this is going to be an amazing night. Next minute, we heard, woo, 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 and I think, what's that? I think, and then there's like sirens going off on the lift. They basically got stuck halfway in the lift. So I'm like that. So we had to pry it open, and all you could see is the faces like that. One's hyperventilating because they don't like closed spaces. And I'm thinking, oh my God, this is just the worst time of my life.
Oh, that must have cost. Did that cost a bit as well to get someone else?
1,500 quid. So it cost me 1,500 quid, and my cousins, like, they still owe me for that. But yeah, so. But you know what? It was all right, because after that, catwalk still went on. We still had a good time. We all got pissed. And can you swear on your?
Yeah, of course you can. Too late now. He's been putting videos up to the camera and everything.
Sorry, Mum. yeah, but it was a good night anyway.
Just before I let you go, Si, I just want you to plug, obviously, your photography and that, and what you do, because you're one of the most talented I know in that game. So
star, man.
Plug away.
He's
mate.
My brother. You know, I'm back based in Muggle. My studio's back in Muggle. You know, I've worked in the fashion game for years, working with some amazing brands like Harvey Nicks. Up until the pandemic, I used to do the autumn winter tours, which was amazing. And yeah, you know, you name it, I'll shoot it.
Brilliant.
But not literally. But yeah.
No worries, Si. Thank you very much for your time. But you have to do one of them, lads. You've got to stick to all
these. Sorry, COVID.
Listen, if you need anything shooting, anything like that, get in touch with Si. Instagram, okay? Thank you very much for coming, mate. Right, guys, thank you for tuning in for another episode of Friday Night with Dean Aldridge. To end the show is Daisy Gill singing Flying High. This is out next month, don't forget. Make sure you all download. Daisy.